I tried. I tried to warn them. I told them this path was not safe. But did they listen? No, of course not. If we cut through the Straits of Messina, we'll be back in Cephalonia with time to spare, the captain told me. That's the thing with merchants. Always so greedy. I told them this path was not safe. There was not a single ship to be seen. The local fishermen never came this way, because they knew what horrors awaited. I can hear their screams now as she tears them and this ship apart, plank by plank and limb by limb. It is too late for me and this crew. But anyone reading this message, heed my warning. Turn back. Turn back the way you came and do not think of this place again, for this path is not safe. For those who do not believe the stories, once you reach her rock, you will know true terror, for you are now in Scylla's domain. Before we delve further into Scylla's story, this video is made possible by today's sponsors, Vikings War of Clans, a free-to-play strategic RPG inspired by the real-time strategy games of the 90s. If like me you grew up playing Age of Empires, Civilization, or even Age of Mythology, then Vikings provide you the chance to relive those memories and create new ones, because the game not only boasts a stunning set of detailed graphics, but is extremely easy for new players to learn. Join the other 20 million players on Vikings and forge alliances in a world that is constantly changing and evolving as you compete in real-time events and battle for resources. Support my channel by downloading Vikings for free using the links in the description below, and you'll receive 200 free gold coins and a protective shield. The game is available on both iOS and Android, so help me out by clicking on the links and checking Vikings War of Clans out today. When we think of Greek mythology, there are certain beasts and monsters that come to mind. Some of these are slightly misunderstood, and others were rightfully feared. Today we'll take a look at Scylla, a monster that we have mentioned in the past, but never really covered in her own video. For those who have never heard of Scylla, or who may be unfamiliar with her tale, she was largely regarded as a hideous monster found off the coast of mainland Italy, in the Straits of Messina, a narrow stretch of water with Scylla located atop the rocks on one side, and the whirlpool monster known as Charybdis on the other. Any ship that dared to cross the Straits of Messina would be torn apart by Scylla, as she plagued the seas for years on end, with the exact number of sailors slain by Scylla unknown. Though we can make the assumption that out of all of the creatures in Greek myth, her kill count must have been amongst the highest. Scylla's appearance, as most things in Greek mythology, has certainly undergone some changes over the years. Before we examine these changes, we should first take a look at the origins of her name, because that offers us some insight into what she may have actually looked like. The version that is most commonly used today in English is Scylla, with a soft sound in C, but as we already know, the soft sound in C replaced the K in many Greek words, and sometimes these words still sound quite similar, but Scylla in Greek is pronounced Scylla. Her name was believed to have originated from the word Skylleros, which means hermit crab, and some of you may already know that Skyllos in Greek means dog, which was quite often one of her defining characteristics. The classical depictions of Scylla portrayed her as a goddess of the sea, with a fish tail and numerous dogs emerging from around her waist. So it's clear to us that Scylla wasn't always regarded as a monster. There are even accounts where she was described as a beautiful nymph. However, in these stories, beauty often comes with consequences, be it in the form of hubris or jealousy. If there's one thing we've learnt from Greek mythology, it's that beautiful nymphs or maidens may not remain very beautiful for long. Scylla is another example of transmutation as a form of punishment, another unfortunate individual that we can add to the list of those transformed from something that was once a symbol of beauty into a monster. Over time, she became less and less human. She was described as having six serpentine-like heads, and her fishtail was completely taken away. In several accounts, Scylla lost all traces of her humanity, and she resembled something closer to a hydra than a fish-tailed goddess. There are some rather interesting interpretations of Scylla that paint her as a monster, but still implement some of the classical aspects of her appearance. These serpent-like heads became a mixture between a serpent and a canine, and they were now attached to a grotesque human body, painting a stark contrast between the once beautiful woman and the cursed, deformed, hideous monster she became. Now that we have a rough idea of who or what Scylla was, we can move on to our next glaring question. What did Scylla do that was so bad for her to be transformed into this monster? There isn't really one clear answer, because we have several different tales that attempt to tell the story of how and why she became what she did. Both Ovid and the Latin author Hyginus believed that Scylla was a beautiful maiden, and in these interpretations, the fisherman turned god of the sea Glaucus had fallen in love with her, but when he finally approached her, she was repulsed because he had the body of a fish. Out of ideas, Glaucus turned to the enchantress Circe, asking her to make him a potion that would cause Scylla to fall in love with him. However, Circe herself had fallen in love with Glaucus, and she did her best to convince him to forget Scylla and marry her instead. But Glaucus replied that the trees would grow on the ocean floor, and seaweed would grow on the highest mountain before he would stop loving Scylla. Cersei, furious at his rejection, did not wish Glaucus any harm, so she decided that Scylla would ultimately pay the price. She took her noxious roots and sprinkled them into the pool where Scylla would bathe. When Scylla came wading into the pool, Cersei began muttering her incantations. The transformation had begun, and canines sprang from her waist, described as having gaping jaws, like those of Hades' vile hound Cerberus. She looked down where her legs once were, but there was nothing, only the midriff of a pack of barking dogs. Glaucus saw his love transformed into a monster, weeping at the cruelty shown by Cersei. Ovid does further describe Scylla as having the face of a sweet girl, with a pack of raging dogs at her waist, luring sailors in with her innocence, only to murder them. Hyginus instead describes her as a monster with four eyes, six grisly heads, each lined with three rows of sharp teeth, 12 tentacle-like legs, and a cat's tail. In the 1818 retelling of this story by John Keats, instead of poisoning Scylla, Cersei instead murders her. Glaucus then takes her corpse to his crystal palace, located at the bottom of the sea, a place where lovers who died at sea can be found. Keats' story, however, has somewhat of a happier ending, as thousands of years later, Scylla is resurrected and reunited with Glaucus. There is another popular rendition of Scylla's transformation story, and this comes from the Greek poem Dionysiaca, written by Nonus. This story is somewhat similar to that of Glaucus and Circe, only with different characters. Instead, it's Poseidon who assumes the role of her lover, and after sleeping with Scylla, Poseidon transforms her into a cliff in the water, the same cliffs we're told the monster resides in. As to why Poseidon did this, honestly, your guess is as good as mine, as Poseidon's motives are at times quite similar to Zeus's, because he felt like it or because he could. This version and Poseidon's involvement were further explained by the 12th century poet John Tetzes, who believed Scylla was a beautiful nymph of the sea who had an affair with Poseidon. It was then Poseidon's wife Amphitrite, who out of jealousy poisoned the spring where she would bathe, transforming her into the monster that we know today. With her appearance and how she became a monster out of the way, we're left with her parentage and the stories she was involved in. In the video we made a while ago about Lamia, we discussed how in the interpretations where Lamia was regarded as an enormous shark, she was seen as a potential mother to Scylla, as parts of Scylla's name translated to mean dog shark, but this is a theory that is not often explored, and one that seems far less plausible than the others. The most common explanation we have as to who Scylla's mother was comes from a collection of authors, including Ovid, Homer, Servius, and Plato, who all agree her mother was Crataeus, which was one of the names given to the sea goddess Ceto. Ovid and Homer never mention Scylla's father, but the others seem to believe it was either Triton, the son of Poseidon, or Phorces, another one of the primordial sea deities, with Phorces being Ceto's husband, and the two being responsible for creating many of the sea's female spirits, creatures, and monsters. Ceto and Phorces being Scylla's parents does make sense. Hyginus, on the other hand, believed that Scylla was the offspring of Typhon and Echidna, and judging by her monstrous appearance, that would be a fair argument to make, but then you would also have to disregard the idea that she was a maiden turned into a monster. Another name you'll see mentioned a fair amount when discussing Scylla's mother is Hecate, but this is one I personally don't understand the reasoning behind. So now onto the part of the video that I'm sure many of you have been waiting for, the stories that Scylla appeared in as a monster. The most famous example, of course, being in Homer's Odyssey, where Odysseus and his crew have to sail through the Straits of Messina, with Charybdis on one side and Scylla on the other. Scylla is not of mortal kind, she is a deathless monster, grim and baleful, savage, not to be wrestled with. Against her there is no defense, and the best path is the path of flight. If you pause to arm beside that rock, I fear that she may dart out again, seize again with as many heads and snatch as many men as before. No, row hard and invoke Crataeus. She is Scylla's mother, it is she who bore her to plague mankind. Here we see Odysseus being advised by Circe. She tells him that he should sail closer to Scylla, in order to avoid his ship and its crew being dragged down to the depths of the ocean by Charybdis. She also tells Odysseus that Scylla will snatch as many men as she has heads, and that he must speak to Scylla's mother Crataeus, to ensure that she will not attack the ship twice. Odysseus, accepting that he could not defeat Scylla, chose to sail around Charybdis, and when passing Scylla she did attack the ship, snatching and devouring six of his men. These men served as a necessary sacrifice, with Odysseus and the rest of his crew sailing onwards. However, Odysseus would unfortunately still encounter Charybdis later on in his journey. This encounter with Scylla gave birth to the Greek idiom, between Scylla and Charybdis, which refers to a situation with two undesirable outcomes, having to choose the lesser of two evils. Some of you may still hear a version of this proverb today, between a rock and a hard place, which itself still kind of describes the encounter with Scylla, as well as having its own meaning. When Jason and his Argonauts came across the Straits of Messina, the goddess Hera warned the Argonauts of what awaited them. She then proceeded to instruct the sea goddess Thetis to offer them safe passage, avoiding the clutches of Charybdis and Scylla. These two stories, I think, do tell us quite a bit about Scylla and the fear surrounding her. You have Jason and his Argonauts and Odysseus, some of Greek mythology's most iconic heroes, and they're both being told that they have no chance in defeat in Scylla, to the point where they shouldn't even try. Instead, the advice given to them by both Circe and Hera is to sail past Scylla. Like most monsters in Greek mythology, Scylla's reign would eventually come to an end, with several poets agreeing that she was slain by Heracles, the exact details of which are never really alluded to, so we can only guess and imagine how epic that battle would have been. There were also a few accounts that listed Scylla as one of the many creatures that guarded the underworld, perhaps guarding one of its many rivers. So what conclusions can we draw from Scylla as a whole? There are definitely some similarities between Scylla and several other monsters that were once considered beautiful maidens or even human. Scylla, like many before, found herself in the middle of a conflict, or even a love triangle in some cases, and if there's anything that Lamia, Medusa, and several others have taught us, it's that if you find yourself in between two deities, whether you're in the midst of a conflict or a troublesome marriage, then it's very likely that you're in trouble. We don't really know much about Scylla before she was transformed, other than the fact that she was repulsed by Glaucus's fish-like body, so there is definitely some irony in her classical depictions somewhat resembling a fish or a hermit crab. When Scylla was eventually transformed, we have a variety of different depictions, but with time she became more of a monster, and this does seem to match her description. If you have a creature that even the gods are advising the Greek heroes to avoid, then you'd expect a monstrous appearance to match these fears. To some, Scylla may not have even been a woman or a monster at all. There is the notion that Scylla was used as a way to rationalize dangerous rocks and reefs in uncharted areas that would take the lives of Greek mariners who first ventured into the Western Mediterranean. There is no doubt that Scylla is one of Greek mythology's deadliest creatures on both land and sea, and this is why we see her in so many literary works and paintings. So let me know what you think of Scylla. Did you happen to know any of her backstory? And do you prefer to think of her as a symbol of danger in uncharted seas, or as a monster of epic proportion? So if you haven't already seen the announcement trailer up on the channel, we've just finished working on our very first book, which is now available for you guys to pre-order. The book itself is a fictional retelling of some of our favourite Greek stories, with illustrations, explanations, and characters explored like never before. I'll leave a link in the description for those of you located in the US to check out the book on Amazon. If you do happen to live outside of the United States, you can still pre-order the book from your country's version of Amazon and most online major book retailers. Don't forget to check out today's sponsors, Vikings War of Clans, who will also be linked in the description of this video. As always, I've been your host, Mythology and Fiction Explained.